We are here, we people, to protest against the situation in the mission, against the murder, colonization, displacement that is happening in the mission. We are here to protest and to fight against the law that are letting the rich to evict people from their houses. Estamos aquí hoy para protestar, para luchar contra las leyes discriminatorias que están sacando a nuestras gentes de la misión. Estamos aquí luchando en contra de la nueva o moderna colonización imperialista que se vive en San Francisco. Hoy, en San Francisco, en los últimos años, estamos viendo cómo el Estado, el gobierno, está ayudando, está del lado de los ricos, de los terratenientes, de las corporaciones, de los desarrolladores de vivienda, sacando a la gente de sus casas, haciendo evicciones por simples cosas. Tenemos que parar esta situación. Estamos aquí también porque hasta después de los 500 años de la colonización en México, en América Latina, se sigue viviendo una opresión, se sigue viviendo una colonización. No solamente es aquí en Estados Unidos, es en México, es en otros países de América Latina, es en Siria. Una colonización entre comillas, porque estamos viviendo una época imperialista, expansiva, pero que se vive peores situaciones que las que se vivieron cuando llegaron los colonizadores a América. Estamos aquí, Answer Coalition, y vamos a presentar a varios compañeros y compañeras que van a hablar. En primer lugar tenemos a Toya Milenio de Word. Toya.
Este día, para hablar en contra de la gentrificación de Apario. Aquí estamos también haciendo la conexión de los colonizadores de hoy. Ahí en la mesa donde está más información, nosotros tenemos tres casas. Ahí está el Trump, los colonizadores de hoy es el Trump. También está el Mayor Lee, que representa los intereses de la gente que está gentrificando acá en la misión. A ver, Columbus también, que venga acá en este continente a colonizar y expulsar los pueblos indígenas. Y después, aquí en California, que veo los colonizadores de los americanos a expulsar a los mexicanos que aquí era México. Y ahora somos nosotros de inmigrantes, pero aquí era donde sea de nosotros. Y lo mismo se pasa en la misión. Cuando uno dice que es muy difícil vivir en la misión, a conseguir un lugar para vivir en la misión, porque cada vez que llega un taxi a más, sale un latino. Pero los latinos nosotros no estamos encarados a otros. Al menos aquí dice que here today to talk about, again, the discrimination of the nation, but also to make a connection with the colonizers of today. We have sponsors of a day here today, but symbolize it. Who's the colonizers of today? They're Columbus. Trump is one of the colonizers. When the text says that it's hard to find a place to live in the mission, the reason is because every time you find a place to move in is because a Latino has to move out. And we all being kicked out of the mission and having to go to faraway neighborhoods. Our children have to go to other neighborhoods where they used to go to school here. People who live here for 20 years are having to move to Oakland because they cannot stay here anymore. But until they come back here, you're going to see the dead in the streets because this is the neighborhood. But every time you're pleading for a place to move in, think about those who have to move out for you to move in. The means is for everybody, but you should think about those who have been here for over 20 years, who have been forced out of their homes so you can move in. Think about that, that's the result of your actions. Every time I think in it, restaurant opens up and you go there to have your dinner, it's because the family run business, the neighborhood business was kicked out. There are being places here will be forever in mission, and now they have paid ridiculous $10,000 rent to stay, and it's impossible. Nosotros del bairro queremos mantener el bairro. If you like the neighborhood and if you like the culture of the neighborhood, respect that. Think twice about your actions. When you move in, you're kicking people out. And we are here today to talk about it. To talk about Columbus who kicked the native and killed and genocide the native people in this continent. To talk about people like Trump who thinks that we are immigrants. Meanwhile, California used to be Mexico. This was invaded by the United States. They came in, we didn't. And also to talk about Mayor Lear, who is working with the gentrifiers, who is working with the people who are killing, for removing the Latinos out of the mission. So this is what we're here today about, and I invite you all to come to the table and get more material. We have a lot of information you can get more and get a bit more. Thank you.
Because sometimes when this news is being given to you, You just passed them over. And you prefer to watch dumb movies or dumb commercials that missing what is really important to you and to the kids that are coming behind you. Christopher Columbus here come to colonize, to conquer us. Take him over, to take our people, use them as slaves. And so that is 500 years ago, more than 500 years ago. The best thing's going on, still going on. Why is it that they don't want immigrants to come here? If you look around, all these buildings, big and small, in the downtown or around the mission and other areas. Big and small, these buildings have been built by the hands of black people and other minorities. So we have to fight and we have to reclaim, we have to defend that we, the minority people, which we are not minority really, we are majority. The minority is much less than 1%. It's not that they want to control the richness, the wealth of this country. And we are just sitting here like sitting ducks because we don't want to do anything, we don't want to be bothered. We are making $5 an hour, and we are happy that the white man is handing us $5. And we are so grateful and ready to kiss their ass when they offer us $6. That doesn't have to be the way. No, that doesn't have to be that way. We are not worthless people. We are people important that produce and generate richness and wealth and well-being in this country. It's about time. It's about time that you take a closer look and come and talk to us and convince us that we are not worth it. Come over. Come over and tell me. Come over and tell to any one of these people here that we are worthless. Come over. We're going to be talking about the same thing, discrimination, racism, poverty, health care, housing, work, employment. Yes, we're going to be talking about all the issues that concern to you. But you don't want to hear it, because you are satisfied making $6 or $9 an hour. Has to be that way. Doesn't have to be that way. No. Are we going to introduce another speaker? And you better listen, because we are talking to you. We are not talking to the wall, we are not talking to the church, we are not talking to the pole. We are talking to you who are passing by, to you who don't want to stop. And listen, what is important to you? Because that is a super program going on today. Stop and listen. We're talking to you because this is important to every one of us who are considered minorities or who are fighting for justice. We're gonna have Magda, who is a real fighter and who is determined to make changes in this society, and if possible, anywhere what is needed to be to have changes made. With us, Magda.
Thank you, Rosa. Buenas tardes. Good afternoon. One of the things that's important to talk about is the relationship, the connection between colonization of the Americas and what's happening here in the Mission and in San Francisco in general. on this banner behind me, it talks about Columbus having not occupied the Americas, but that people, millions of people, were already living here. So Columbus and the other people along with him invaded the Americas, and they basically occupied it, and then they massacred the people. The reason they did this is that basically the Spanish monarchy and the rest of the monarchies in Europe thought that all this land was too good to be left to the native peoples. They wanted it for themselves, they wanted to steal the resources, the land, the riches, everything. And how is that related to what we see going on in San Francisco today? Well, the big banks, the corporations, the companies see as San Francisco as too good of a land to be left for working people, black and brown people, communities of color, oppressed communities. They think it's just too good. So they just want to gentrify it. They want to evict people, they want to force people out. They're building all these luxury condos and apartments. And this is not something that's just happening by itself. The government is helping them. Mayor Ed Lee is in their pocket. The way they exert their power is through their money. The banks, the insurance companies, the big corporations want this to be happening, the tech companies, of course. And so this is affecting the communities in San Francisco because we are being pushed out. And it's not just some kind of a natural process. The government, the big banks, the corporations are part of it.
Would you like to get on our list?
Is this something that's just going to happen and we can't do anything about it? No, no. We can do something about it. We can fight back. But our weapon is not, we don't have the kind of money that the banks and the corporations do. We don't have the mayor in our pockets, of course. Mayor Lee is not here to serve us. He's here to serve the Bank of Americas and the rest of the big, big businesses. But our weapon is to fight back the same way that people have fought back for centuries. People fight back against racism, against gentrification, against eviction, against war, against injustice, by organizing, by banding together, by mobilizing, by force, by forming a united force. So that's what we're doing here. It's not the beginning. A lot of us have been fighting for a long time, but we're building up momentum. People are joining us. People are understanding that the only way to fight back the gentrification of San Francisco, the pushing out of working people from San Francisco, the only way to do that, the only way to fight back the gentrification, in a way the colonization of San Francisco, is to organize and force the city government and the banks and the builders and the developers and the landlords to back down. So that's why we're inviting people to pick up our literature, to join us, the Answer Coalition, Act Now to Stop War and End Racism. Anywhere where there's racism, we're fighting against it, and gentrification is also a racist policy, and that's an important thing to keep in mind, because it's communities of color, working people, but in particular communities of color, and here in the Mission, primarily the Latino community, that's being pushed out in favor of the dot-coms and the banks, and with all of their luxury condos and everything. So we want San Francisco to have working people in it. We don't want it to be gentrified. We don't want anyone to be evicted. We want a halt in the building of luxury condos that's speeding up the changing of San Francisco. And the way we do it is organized together along with all working people. So I invite people to join this struggle. Sign up at the table, pick up literature, and keep in mind, we have to do this, and it will work. We can win victory, but we'll have to organize and we'll have to be united.
Bueno, buenas tardes, misión. ¿Cómo están? Estamos aquí hoy para hacerles un llamado, para convocarles a que se unan con nosotros y poner un alto a los ataques contra el pueblo trabajador, a los ataques racistas contra los inmigrantes, a los ataques racistas contra la gente negra. Tenemos que estar organizados. Es lo que nos decía Maza, que si queremos tener una victoria, si queremos parar la gentrificación, si queremos parar las evicciones, si queremos pasar los desalojos y queremos tener vivienda accesible para todo trabajador, tenemos que organizarnos. El Estado, el gobierno, los ricos, ellos sí están organizados, están muy bien organizados en sus partidos demócratas y republicanos. Ellos tienen representación, tienen mucho dinero, y nosotros también podemos organizarnos y dar una respuesta firme contra esos ataques. Tal vez usted no ha sido desalojado de su vivienda, tal vez es dueño, pero si usted ha conocido personas que han sido desalojadas y se han ido de San Francisco, fuera de aquí del área, porque ya el dinero no alcanza. A continuación tenemos a la compañera Dina del TSL.
Brothers and sisters, as rents are skyrocketing and longtime residents are being pushed out of their communities, the developers, the landlords, and the lackeys in City Hall are celebrating. Mayor Ed Lee held a meeting last month with the big developers, and his comments showed clearly whose side he is on. He said, quote, "It's a good time for San Francisco. People are working. Cranes are up. I can see them. There are some people who are fearful of change being too fast for them. I believe in change. There is so much going on that is so positive," unquote. This is our mayor. He doesn't care about us in our communities being pushed out, being struggling, having three jobs to pay rent. For the average person in San Francisco, there's been nothing positive about this new wave of gentrification. The fabric of our communities is being ripped apart. Families are being pushed out. Our public schools have a shortage of teachers because teachers can't afford rent in San Francisco. Homelessness is a growing epidemic while luxury condos sit vacant, being bought by absentee owners who are just looking for an investment. Ed Lee says he wants all the homeless removed from San Francisco for the Super Bowl in 2016. But his solution, of course, is not to house the homeless or to build low-income housing or expand social services. His solution is to drive them out. He basically wants to make the extreme poverty that's been created by this tech boom just disappear. The crime of gentrification is not just a problem in the Bay Area. It's happening in cities all over the U.S. It is not just a product of a bad mayor. It is inherent to the system that we live in, the capitalist system, that always puts the drive for profits over a few over the needs of the mass majority. It is the same system that is cutting funds to public schools, that make healthcare a commodity, where tens of thousands of people die every year just because they can't afford care. It's the same system that promotes a racist bigot like Donald Trump. It is the same system that has police terrorizing our black and brown communities. Brothers and sisters, we need to fight against the gentrification of our communities, but we also need to build a movement that says human rights over profit. Sign up at our table, get some flyers, get involved. Our office is just down the street at 2969 Mission Street. Come join the movement, help fight back against this inhumane system. Thank you. Woo!
The oppressors are the same, from Columbus to today. They haven't changed. The only difference is the clothes they were wearing. Before, they were wearing a funny-looking, ridiculous clothes. And now, they are wearing three-piece shirts and ties. And they are driving Mercedes and other luxury cars, when before they were riding horses. But the horses were more noble than the rider. And that's the way it is. And now we're going to hear a poem that was we're going to hear this poem that is going to go straight to your heart.
Janet Casa, soy de Tijuana. Primero que nada, quiero que todos se den cuenta de que gentrificación aquí en San Francisco es la nueva colonización. Está sucediendo lo mismo, como dijo nuestra compañera, solamente son personas con carros y no caballos, son personas que tienen dinero y que no vienen de España, son personas que están de aquí mismo. Entonces, todos deberían de estar, pues, enojados. Y aquí tengo un poema que escribí que se llama Mexicana en Gringolandia. Y después espero que les guste. Yo soy Vianey, perdida en un mundo de confusión. I am Vianey, lost in a world of confusion. Me dicen, decídete, pocha, ¿qué prefieres, Gringolandia o Mexicana? En Café de Tacuba, en Mexico City, he asked me, do you like living in Gringolandia? In hipster gentrifying coffee shops de San Francisco, she asked me, would you rather be in Mexico? Pero yo soy Vianey, lost in a world of confusion. Two roads diverge my yellow road, dijo Robert Frost. Como invasora cruzando la frontera Gringolandia this way, Mexico that way. I take the road to Mexico y me convierto en el 44. Leave me to Ayotzinapa where I can't be a student o me cortan los dedos y me entierran ensangrentada. Lead me to Acapulco, where I can't be a teacher o me arrancan los ojos y me dejan tirada. Lead me to Ostula, where I can't be a kid o me disparan las costillas y me roban la inocencia. Lead me to Juárez, Ecatepec, todo México, where I can't be a woman, me matan, me violan, me tocan y se burlan. Say I take the road to Gringolandia, off to el pinche sueño americano, off to the land of freedom. Pero ¿cuál pinche freedom? My sueño was not to be demonized for being Mexicana and having piel canela. Say the road leads me to Gringolandia where I can't be Latina or they call me asesina, violadora, puta, invasora before the eyes of a white cis man running for president. Or say the road leads me to Gringolandia if I get there because I'm Latina and Latina immigrants have an 8 out of 10 chance of getting raped at the border. Say I survive leads me to the exotic road because being a Latina in Gringolandia, I either come in violada, embarazada, o mamacita because my skin either disgusts you or turns you on. My attitude either becomes a reason to be arrested or a fantasy para puercos blancos. Say I take the road to Gringolandia where black folks are magic, managing to kill themselves in prison, where black folks can't even breathe, can't even exist, porque piel oscura en Gringolandia es penada con muerte y risas blancas. I am Vianey, and I don't know which road to take. Should I take the one to Mexico, where 6.4 women are murdered every day? Or should I travel to Gringolandia, where there's only 9 days this year in which police haven't killed a black human being? I am Vianey, lost in a world of confusion. Ansaldúa me grita y me pide to live without borders, pero no puedo si los balazos me llegan de los dos lados. En México los españoles me desnudaron y robaron mi esencia because my indígenas brothers and sisters were dirty salvajes. En Gringolandia, my mother was arrested and deported because she couldn't speak proper English and she had no money because Latinas are dirty salvajes. En Gringolandia, republicanos take pride in preventing abortion, controlling my body to save lives. But what if my baby came out gay, brown, mujer, o inteligente? What if my baby grew up to become transsexual? ¿Cómo sobrevivir en las borderlands en Saldúa si la sangre me llega por todos lados? Pero let me answer for those who ask. Ya no sé a dónde irme, but I won't give them the satisfaction of me running away. If I'm killed, I will rest in power and my people will march and scream for me. If I survive, I will make sure I am never destroyed. Sus dos sistemas le temen a los despiertos, and one day this won't hurt anymore. One day I will rise and grow taller than this metal monster dividing my people. Y en los dos lados soy la misma Malinche, la misma Eva y la misma Llorona. I will rise and the systems will be afraid of me. It will be their turn to run for me because I'm Vianey, chingona in a world of confusion. Soy mexicana, soy latina, soy mujer, soy estudiante, soy la que piensa, soy la protesta y soy la rebelde. I am Vianey, survivor of a world of confusion, and I am more than what Gringolandia y Peña Nieto make of me. Thank you.
Thank you, muchas gracias por tan precioso poema. Le dije que iba a llegar straight to your heart, and it did. Right? Well, we're going to continue here, and we're going to have Richard Baker Senator, who is a very strong believer in human rights and a fighter, very determined to see the end of injustice in this country and all over the world. Here it is. Here we have a Richard Vicker from ANSWER.
Thank you. And that was really I just want to ask a couple of questions. One being, do we really live in a democracy? Well, one answer to that question was on the front page of the New York Times this morning. And it said that 156 families in the United States have donated more than half of the money, all the hundreds of millions of dollars raised by the candidates for president. There's about 100 million families in the United States, maybe 120 million, but just 156 of them, all who live in their own little hidden communities in Houston and Los Angeles, outside New York, here in the Bay Area. So who's going to determine who the nominees are for president? Is it going to be us, or is it going to be the 156 families who've given already $150 million? And another thing about democracy I want to mention, and this was brought up earlier, is Mayor Lee decided to give Twitter a tax break for 10 years, that they wouldn't have to pay payroll taxes, and that was supposed to be good for the economy and good for all of us. Has it been good for all of us? I don't think so. In fact, it's been very bad for most of us, and it's been especially bad for this community. I have lived in the Mission for 34 years, and I remember when it was a far, far different place than it is today. By giving that tax break to Twitter and encouraging Twitter to come here, they brought in people who could pay rent that was three times what the residents here were paying. And what did the landlords think about that? Were the landlords thinking, for the most part, there's a few good landlords, I guess, but most of the landlords were thinking, really? How can I get rid of my present tenants and rent my apartment to somebody who will pay, instead of $1,000 a month for a two-bedroom apartment, how it was not so long ago, but now they'll pay $4,000 for that apartment. So instead of a system that works for us, we live in a system that is run by and works for the rich. There is really no question about that. It's a system where the rights of private property, the rights of profit, come before the rights of the people. And if we didn't spend $1 trillion a year on militarism, there'd be enough money to have housing for everybody, and health care for everybody, and free education for everybody, all the way through university. That military doesn't protect us, it protects the interests of empire. We live in a system where that empire exists for the benefit of those 156 families who are choosing who the next president will be. The Walton family owns as much wealth, one family, as 142 million people in the United States. Let me say that again. One family, the Waltons, the Walmart family, owns as much wealth as the poorest 142 million people in this country. And today, as Tina said earlier, 40% of the luxury housing that has gone up in the city sits empty. It's an investment. It's an investment by the well-to-do and by the rich. It's one of their many investments. So we see more and more people living on the street at the same time as there are more and more empty housing units. What kind of a system is this? I would say that if someone came from another planet and they looked at this system, they would say, this system is insane. It's an insane system where millions of people can be homeless and 20 million housing units can be empty. But it's not insane if you're one of the 156 families. For
the 156 families, for the rich and the super rich, not even the 1%, the 1/10th or the 1/100th of 1% who really run the system, it's great. For the rest of us, it's a crazy system, and it's a system that's got to go, and that's only going to happen when the people take action to make it happen. Thank you.
For us, to get future for us and for our people, for our sons, for our daughters, grandsons, it's time to fight back. There is no way. Gente, ha llegado el momento, es tiempo de que nos organicemos, de que dejemos la modorra, la flojera, el ahí se va, el que me importa, y que empiecen, que empecemos a organizarnos, a formar organización. Júntense con nosotros, júntense Answer Coalition, conformen su organización para combatir los ataques. Hoy en San Francisco estamos viviendo situaciones muy lamentables contra la gente de color, contra la gente pobre, por las evicciones, por los desalojos. Y esto y es legal. Tenemos que luchar y tener leyes que nos protejan, luchar contra las leyes discriminativas y luchar por viviendas y luchar por nuestros derechos. A continuación voy a presentar a la compañera Ruby from WORD. Now is going to talk Ruby. She is a member of WORD. You will organize to resist and defend. Welcome, Ruby.
Hello, my name is Ruby Elson, and I'm a senior in high school. Throughout my years in the California education system, I've learned a couple things, or so I thought. What I've been taught throughout the years is that America was founded off of Locke's theory of government, that we were to have the right to happiness, or the pursuit of happiness, life and liberty, and that, wait, hang on a second, because last time I checked, Locke's theory was that we had the right to life, liberty, and property. But within the Declaration of Independence, they changed that just a little bit so that they could really do whatever they want, essentially. And even though the Declaration of Independence isn't part of the Constitution, that's what we're taught in school. What we were taught is that America was founded when people came together under a social contract to create a government. But in reality, that's not what happened. America was founded off of murder, rape, and genocide. Thank you, Columbus. Going on, right? According to Locke, people have the right to rebel when governments become shitty. So by at this point, we should have been rebelling a long, long time ago. And yet, we're just not. Why? Because we are fooled and brainwashed and socialized into thinking that this is the way that things should be. In fact, my brother, a white, cis, straight male, who's in college, USC, a good school, he's like, you know what, man? Gentrification, that's just the way of progress, you know? That's just how it works. But no, that's not how it works. That's how it works under a system of capitalism, where corporations have more rights than I do, where healthcare is only amendable for the top 1%. So in reality, gentrification is just another way for colonizers to stick their fists in the people's face. Moving on, right? Right. So, at my school, I run a club called WORD, part of a national organization, Women Organized to Resist and Defend. We are resisting the patriarchy, the capitalistic government, and we are defending our autonomy. So many times at school, I am often stopped, harassed, and say, hey, Loki want to fight with you. Not all men. Not all men. And, but even though this thing isn't about not all men, it kind of is. Because this is the same thing with not all people are capitalists. Not all people think that we shouldn't have health care. It's the same issue. It is the same issue. Because when black people and brown people are gunned down in the streets by policemen, and almost immediately afterwards new condos are being built up, it is not only a sign of saying that people who have different color of skin are not welcome here, but it is a sign that says that rich people and white people now have the right to stay here. I think I'm going to wrap this up. Who's next? Anyone? All right. Yeah, let's bring Norma up. Woo!
Hola, buenas tardes. Gente que esté pasando, estamos aquí también para invitarles que se una este miércoles 14 de octubre a las 4:30 de la tarde aquí para un meeting y una marcha contra Trump, por justicia en México, fuera Peña Nieto, contra la gentrificación. Estamos aquí, estaremos aquí también apoyando a México en el paro nacional que ese mismo día lo tienen. Gracias, no se les olvide, 4:30, miércoles 14.
¿Quién va a parar la injusticia en este país? Nosotros lo vamos a hacer. Who's going to stop injustice in this country? We're going to do it. And you are supposed to join us. You should come over because this is in your own interest. And if you don't get this, you're screwed up. We're going to hear now from Nick, who's going to be speaking. He's going to be speaking about the
party. You always do that people who lived in that neighborhood knew before he went to work. But the gentrification of Fernald, which at that time was supposed to be the hottest county in the United States for real estate interests, was being gentrified and is now no longer affordable by even myself. So the new gentrifiers called the police to say that there was a Latino man on the mission in Vernal Hill with a gun because he had a yellow belted a taser, a clearly identifiable taser, and he was shot more than seven times by seven cops and was killed. And that's gentrification. But we can, and it doesn't have to be this way, and this group of people talking today, the people listening, we're really a nucleus of what could be, what's possible. Because if you go back about 8 years to early 2007, in the U.S. Senate, a bill was being sponsored called the Sensenbrenner Bill. And it was going to make it was going to make every single worker from anywhere in the world who came to this country who did not have documents, because they were forced here by the policies of the same 1% that exploit and gentrify the mission, exploit and gentrify their communities, their countries, and force people to come here to survive. The U.S. Senate, the Senate of the billionaires, I think there's not a single non-millionaire in the Senate, they were going to make it a felony just to be standing on the ground in this country without proper papers. And worse, on top of that, any social service provider that helped a person without papers would be also a felon. May 1st, which is a holiday of the working class, of poor working people, May Day, 12 million immigrant workers stopped working May 1st, 2007. At the culmination of demonstrations of tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of people, mostly immigrants and supporters, the Party for Socialism and Liberation participated in these demonstrations, and they said, no more.
Put your money in the war machine, we can make you
the
rich.
People united will never be defeated. El pueblo unido jamás será vencido. That was the call that day. That day, that That was the vote that killed the Sensenbrenner bill when 12 million people marched with their feet, voted with their feet and said, we will not work anymore if you continue to criminalize us. That's the kind of movement that can stop gentrification, can stop police brutality, can stop the racists from being emboldened by the rhetoric of Donald Trump. Imagine if there's about 800,000 people that live in San Francisco. I would gather that at least 700,000 of us work for a living and feel insecure about our futures because we have no job security. Even if we own a home, it's a struggle to make ends meet. If you're without papers, if you're undocumented, you're particularly vulnerable because of the racist nature of the system. What if we all decided Monday, Columbus Day, so-called Columbus Day, we decided not to go to work? Well, maybe some of us don't have to work. Tuesday, we decided not to go to work and said, we will not work until gentrification stops, until there's a moratorium on evictions, and until we take all the people that are living six families to two rooms, the people that are living on the streets, and house them in these luxury condos that we built. The construction workers, many who are immigrant workers, who build these homes, can't even afford to live in the city because of the gentrification. But we can change that. That's the kind of movement that can change things. So as you walk by and you listen and you say, what can we do? I agree with you. The system sucks. It's racist. It's sexist, it's anti-gay, it's anti-poor, it's anti-immigrant. How do we change it? We change it by building a movement because we are the 99%. And without the 99, the 1% get nothing and make no money. But we have to organize. Poor and working people have done that throughout history to improve our lives. We're going to need to do that again. We can stop the gentrification of the mission. And we can raise the slogan from May 1st of 2007, the people united will never be defeated. El pueblo unido jamás será vencido. El pueblo unido jamás será vencido.
Así es. Solamente la organización. Sí, no me oigo. Bueno, la organización, la lucha, es lo que nos puede garantizar a los trabajadores de San Francisco, a la gente de San Francisco, ganar, ir ganando. De otra manera, los ricos, el gobierno van a seguir aliados en contra nuestra. Parte de los problemas que tenemos hoy por la vivienda en San Francisco, se deben también por la credibilidad que tiene mucha gente con el Partido Demócrata y que dan sus votos a líderes que prometen y que no nos representan. Nosotros sabemos que tanto el Partido Demócrata como el Republicano están juntos y que no nos representan. Por eso es muy importante que nosotros, como inmigrantes, como trabajadores, como mujeres, como residentes de San Francisco, nos organicemos y luchemos. Es la única solución. A continuación, mire el compañero Daniel. Okay. So, who's next, Jackie?
Buenos días, buenas tardes a todos los compañeros en la misión. En este día que combatimos el coloniaje llamado gentrification. Gentrification implica que quienes vienen a colonizar y explotarnos son gente y nosotros somos nada. Nosotros somos gente. Los colonizadores son nuestros enemigos. En Puerto Rico llegó gentrification, entre comillas, en el 1509. con Ponce de León y Cristóbal Colón. Los indígenas, dado sus mitos, creyeron que los españoles eran dioses y empezaron a ser esclavizados vilmente, criminalmente, y ser asesinados hasta que se levantaron. Una vez se levantaron, dijeron: mataréis al dios del miedo, entonces seréis libres. You will kill the god of fear, then you will be free. La lucha de Puerto Rico, soy puertorriqueño, por supuesto, lleva muchos, más de 500 años por su liberación, por nuestra liberación. Desde España, en 1868, con el grito de Lares, rebelión de Lares, nos levantamos y proclamamos la República de Puerto Rico en Lares, un pueblo del centro de la isla. A pesar de que fue aplastada la rebelión en sus inicios, esto simplemente consagró la nación puertorriqueña. En 1950, en octubre 30 de 1950, fue proclamada la República de Puerto Rico una segunda vez. En este momento, en esos años, Estados Unidos ha sido el poder colonial desde 1898. Los puertorriqueños no solamente se rebelaron en Puerto Rico, sino que trajeron la guerra revolucionaria a la casa de comando del imperio yanqui. Se la trajeron a Washington D.C., donde tirotearon a Truman para que suspendiera los bombardeos contra Puerto Rico. En esos momentos, puertorriqueños hemos estado bien activos contra la gentrificación, contra el aburguesamiento de nuestro país. Actualmente, dada la situación económica y dada la fuga de muchos cerebros, de mucha gran parte de la población, donde nosotros ya hemos sido desplazados en más de un 50% de nuestra población nacional, vive fuera de Puerto Rico, forzado por el imperialismo y el colonialismo. Ahora mismo tratan de imponer otra forma de coloniaje por medio de la especulación de la propiedad real. Lo que sucede igualmente aquí. Yo exhorto a los compañeros que están luchando contra la gentrificación aquí en la misión que se informen lo que está sucediendo en Puerto Rico, porque muchas veces en Puerto Rico, con todas las contradicciones coloniales, podemos salir con soluciones nuevas que podemos contribuir a la lucha dentro de las entrañas del monstruo. E igual puede haber una contribución desde las entrañas del monstruo hacia nuestra nación boricua para contribuir a la lucha para derrotar al imperialismo yanqui en nuestra nación. Ahora en inglés, si me permiten. Since Columbus and Ponce de León landed in Puerto Rico, this has been gentrification of the Americas. That gentrification is a sweet word to disguise colonialism. It's colonialism, plain and simple. It's nothing else. The colonizers come with the power of their money, their weapons, and the brute force to impose their hegemony on the rest of the people they want to control and dominate and oppress. That has been happening in Puerto Rico for 500 years. Even with the resistance of the Puerto Rican people, we have managed to quell it, but not defeat it right now. In 1868, Puerto Ricans rose up in arms against the Spanish oppression of the Spanish Empire and colonialism in Puerto Rico. And we proclaimed the Republic of Puerto Rico for the first time, even though the rebellion was squashed by the Spaniards and the Spanish imperialists, we gained consciousness of being a whole nation. In 1950, October the 30th, we again rose up in arms against the Yankee imperialism that was there in power since 1898 in Puerto Rico. And we brought the struggle and the Revolutionary War to the house, to their own house, here in Washington, D.C., when the Puerto Rican nationalists shot Truman in 1950. We have been a struggle for more than 500 years, and we will continue until we defeat imperialism in our nation. We also want to tell that we, Puerto Ricans, also are not only a alone in this struggle, but we are solidarious also with other struggles. So Puerto Ricans have been solidarious with all the struggles of Latin America for the independence, from Venezuela all the way to Argentina and Cuba and Haiti. We have also been solidarious even with the struggle for independence of the United States in their beginning years. So let's go and unite hands for Puerto Rico, as I ask you right now, in this moment where we're being displaced of our own nation, and there are many political and economic refugees from Puerto Rico coming here to the belly of the beast, and they're not organized, but we shall organize together and fight to win. Viva Puerto Rico Libre! Viva la lucha de los trabajadores!
Viva.
La Internacional vivirá para siempre.
Viva Puerto Rico! Viva Puerto Rico Libre! We're going to hear now from Daniel, another member of the Party for Socialism and Liberation. And so we appreciate very much that you're still hanging around. We need to hear this message. With us, Daniel.
Ladies and gentlemen, we live in a day and age where the idea that someone should live in their own community for their lives, and that their family should prosper in the same community, and that they should remain in their own homes and their own neighborhoods is radical. It's something that people on street corners with microphones yell about. We live in a day and age where we talk about colonialism and Columbus and genocide, and this is radical. The idea that we shouldn't celebrate the enslavement and destruction of an entire world. We live in a day and age where we rush to bail out banks with billions of dollars, but we do not rush to bail out communities and peoples who so desperately need it. Can you imagine a world where the U.S. government rushed with the same aid to deal with things like climate change or the crisis in the pharmaceutical and medical industry, or to provide health care, places to live, places to stay, with the same unlimited wealth and reach that they reached out to J.P. Morgan Chase and Wells Fargo and the many other banks? That is what I'm excited about, a world where we can celebrate and look forward to a government that cares and takes care of its people, because right now it most certainly does not. It cares about the Ed Lees and the Donald Trumps and the Christopher Columbuses of the world. So come, sign up, take a flyer, join the Party of Socialism and Liberation as we can struggle to make a world where the vast and limitless wealth of the United States can enrich human beings, can enrich life, can enrich our communities, and can make this a world worth living in. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel. Thank you so much for your work. Thank you, everybody who has been standing up around here listening to all the speakers this afternoon. It's very important that we come together. Don't take it lightly. We together can fight together, put our efforts together. If this is the only way that we are going to get rid of the false democracy that has been imposed on us, and we're gonna get rid of racism, and we're gonna get rid of all those rich, wealthy, stinky people who hold the money, and how to keep us in poverty is the only way. Get this straight into your mind. The only way we can do it is if we join efforts, put all the efforts together, and fight together for real freedom. When black people, when Latino people, when any other minority group, the LGBT people, when everybody who is minority or feels minority, get together, fight together, we are going to win together. So thank you very, very much. And we're going to be meeting in this corner over and over and over until we win. And we will. Thank you very much. You have a great weekend. And we're going to be... Oh.
that is somebody who wants to say the last word, okay?
A new form of conquering. They lock up our Latino men and they take our women. That's all I have to say. A new form of conquering, such as gentrification. Latinos are still here. We're still represented.
Well, we are very strong. We are a lot of Latinos. There are a lot of Latinos. And believe me, don't look at, because we don't say much. But when we get angry, we really do something and watch out. So, people, let's fight.